Welcome to Hadoop Exam Learning Resources. This will be continuing here from our previous sessions. We have done till a few points. Now let's move ahead, and I would have done till 6 slides. Okay, so now let's move here. Okay, so now let's assume it. We are creating a service and hosting a Java G2 application on Amazon Web Service. So what we are going to design here. So suppose my G2 applications is installed under the these three servers, EC2 instances. Okay, these are the all three computers will be using to host my application, and these are known as, and we deploy G2 application servers on this all three. So let's assume it G2 app server is a WebLogic app servers. We install on all these three machines, and inside the G2 application servers we'll be installing our applications. That is G2 applications, okay, and this entire all three application would be on this this would be stored inside that one private subnet we will be creating. So our one private subnet means we have specific range of IP addresses allocated for this network. Okay, so there are three machines, so we'll be using three IP addresses, so we could have a range of IP addresses for this subnet. It's not only three, that will be more, definitely we'll understand about the subnet. So this subnet is just a range of IP addresses. Similarly, so let's I would say we have some IP addresses, I would say we have 10.0.0 something 24 something. So this is some IP address range. Okay, so this is the notations by which we will assign the IP addresses. What is 24 means I will tell you. So this is classless IP addresses and notation. So there are total 32 bit minus 24, so 8 is available here. So okay, so how would we calculate? I'll go further in later session. So there are some range of IP addresses assigned for this subnet. Okay, so these are the IP addresses available for this subnet. Similarly, we do have three subnets here in this, and the entire all three subnets are part of one VPC, virtual private cloud. This is a bigger box, you can see. So one VPC could have the multiple subnets. So here one VPC is having a three subnet. One is for the hosting the all the G2 application servers, and next is the other servers, other subnets are used for the Oracle database installed on this subnet. Okay, and the next is a network address translations. Okay, so this is the third subnet we have created inside. So these are three subnets. So what happens as a user, you create a request to connect to the G2 application. So you come via internet, and if you come via internet and we want some security or something, so you cannot directly connect to the G2 applications from the internet. So there is some security needs to be applied or something. So for the public access, generally some internet gateway will be used for the public users in between. And from internet gateway, this request comes to the network address translations. What is NAT? I'll discuss later. Okay, and this NAT, from NAT, this request comes to the your G2 application servers, and the similar response will go to the same path. So that's where public user can access your G2 application. But as a you are owner of the application, so you want it to be directly accessed, your application. So some administrative task you wanted to do, so what you could do this, SSL you want to open or something. So what, from your corporate data centers you have some VPN gateway created, and from the VPN gateway your request goes to the directly G2 application server. So this is the in the different subnet, and this is not subnet specific, this is VPN you have installed, and this is the gateway by which you connect your G2 application servers. And definitely you could have connect to the Oracle database as well from the corporate data centers, but it is not like this. This should not be directly available to the internet users, because database needs to be secured. why end user wants to access your database, correct? So that's the reason it's in this private subnet and it is more secure and it's not accessible to the public. Okay, so via this you can access. Obviously, as a pink corporate user using the VPN gateway, you can connect to the Oracle database. Okay, so these are the points here. You will be creating the VPC. Okay, so it generally by default one VPC would be created as soon as you create your AWS EC2 instances. Will use VPN as well to connect from your own premises and data centers. Okay, to connect from your own premises data centers to the AWS gateway applications. Inside the VPC, you will be creating the subnets. Okay, we have discussed, and internet traffic may be created using the network address translations and firewalls. We'll discuss about this later. So these are the architecture we are discussing here. Okay, each private subnet will have specific range of IP addresses. So now similarly, another scenario, we'll be discussing here the some scenarios like how solutions can be implemented in the Amazon Web Service. Similarly, some file stores you want to solutions you want to create for the file storage. So there is a requirement, let's say you want to create have a file servers in your organization, and this files needs to be stored for the backup as well as for the archival. So for like there is a regulatory requirement, the whatever files you have, you need to store it at least for 5 years. So you need archival solutions as well as like if your file server goes down or something, you need the backup of the file as well. So what you are going to do is like this is the end user. You are the user of this files. You are creating the files and etc. So we have a network attached to storage. So file would be submitted to the servers. Okay, so this is whatever the network attached to storage would be created. And for the backup purpose, you would have another network attached storage for the backup. So you will first files come here in network attached storage here, and from here it will go to the backup. Similarly, for the archival purpose, it also go to the tab drive. So we'll be having this multiple things in place. Like this is our in-house solution, how we'll be managed our files, reverse things, actually storing the file and etc. So but you can same thing implement in Amazon Web Service cheaper way and way less managed way. Okay, here you need to buy two network attached storage, one and two phone for backup, and third is a tab drive. This you have to buy it explicitly. Now let's see the solutions from how it can be implemented using the Amazon Web Service. So what you will do, you will be using Amazon S3, okay, as an object storage for the storing your files which you need it as a file server. Okay, so you don't have explicit server, you just store your file in object storage. And for the archival purpose, this virtual private tab drive is available on the Amazon. Okay, so it's not known as tab drive, I would say. I'll discuss about this. Okay, so like there is a one archival solutions is available on Amazon. So what you will be doing, you will be just having this account created for Amazon S3, and from your end user create the file using the storage gateway. This file sent via internet to the Amazon S3 bucket, and in this bucket you will it would be automatically, it just needs configurations to send it to the archival location. So these services are managed by the Amazon, this and this service. You are not responsible for managing this service. Okay, so you just create an account for it and use it, that's all. Okay, so there is no explicit management, you have to do it. And similarly, and the synchronization automatically happens here only in your area. It comes with the storage gateway, so this part you need to manage at your end. So this part is in your data centers, and this is in the Amazon data centers. Okay, so you are only managing just in one storage gateway service. You are managing that is your own site, and from this is data is automatically synchronized with your Amazon S3 object storage, and in the data would be sent to the virtual tape drive. Okay, here. So now this is your company network entirely, and this is your Amazon network. Okay, so that is the point here discuss here, like storing data reliably, all PDF files and documents, these are the requirement. There is one backup for all the files. We have created one backups here, correct? And data is copied from file server to the network attached storage. This from this files are copied here first, and from network storage to the one backup storage that goes here, and then hence there are two NAS server actually we are having, a network attached storage, and the one is tape drive for calling for files. But in new solutions, we don't have this kind of implementation, and we don't have to manage too many things. We just need to take care about the storage gateway. Other services managed by the Amazon. So you are not responsible for managing the service. You just create an account and use this and pay for the services the amount you use it. Hence, there's no need to buy network attached storage using storage gateway. You can synchronize files between storage gateway and object storage. Tape drive has to keep the data for 5 years unlimited storage capacity is available, so there is no limit, and it's again Amazon responsibility how much storage you are using. It you can use it as much as you want it. Most of the cases it would be sufficient to use Amazon S3. In this, you are only responsible to manage storage gateway. Example of fault tolerant architectures, correct? So let's take another architectures in the hosting a hadoopexam.com site. What happens is your hadoopexam.com just need one web server and one database. Let's assume it, that's all. You don't need anything. So now what you will do, you need to create a fault tolerant service. Fault tolerant means if one server goes down, still my service should be available. It should never be down. That is expected. If so, you browse www.hadoopexam.com, and if it is not available and you are planning to buy the product, so it is lost to the hadoopexam.com as well as for you, because you are preparing for practical trainings or exams, etc., and this is not available, so this is the loss for both the party. So in such scenario, you should have a very good solution in place that this site can never be unavailable. So let's assume it, we will be having two data centers here, data center A and data center B, and what we will be doing, we will be creating web server in both the data centers, one web server here, one web server here. So these are the two EC2 instances in the different data center. Different data center is different locations. Let's assume this is in the United States and this is in the Japan we have created. So this is the regional or difference in the locations actually, but you could have in the same region different data centers in the various kilometers, 25 to 30 kilometers away from each other. Okay, so this is also possible. So this is the web servers we have created. Okay, and this is the database again on each data center we have created. Now let's assume that this data center is working perfectly fine, and suddenly what happens, this database, the where it is installed, is corrupted or got crashed or something wrong happens. So what happens? So what this web server is to, as soon as the request comes from the end user, like this is the end user via internet, and from internet to the elastic load balancer, this request comes and goes to this server. Okay, and this server says this database is down, I cannot point it. So immediately what it does, it will point this database. Okay, and get the data here. And suppose so one of the them would be available at a time, so you could have even multiple replication and multiple data center across it, but it's very less likely point at both the data center down or something. It's a very big thing for Amazon if both two data centers are down together. So the application is still available via this across this. Now let's assume this EC2 instance itself is down, this database is also down because this entire data center is down. So your request, ELB is responsible directly sending your request to this web server, and from this web servers and from this database, so this service is still available. So in various we have seen the scenarios even the one component is down, entire data center is down, still my services is available. Is it possible the entire ELB is down, and how the request sent would be? So now it is Amazon responsibility, it's a fault tolerant component. You are not responsible to make it fault tolerant. ELB would never be down. This is Amazon responsibility to make it up all the time. So you don't worry about this, ELB will never be down. So this is the what this is components by default fault tolerant. You are not responsible for this. Similarly, this EC2 instances are not fault tolerant by default. You have to create services like this, it would be like to make it fault tolerant. But here databases is not your responsibility. These are the fault tolerant. So this is automatically one master copy and one standby copy would be created by Amazon. So you don't worry about this in the different data centers. So this would be always available. So you are only responsible for the EC2 instances managed by you for this, as we have already discussed in the previous session. So in AWS, you can have databases which are fault tolerant by default. Load balancer is highly available. So this is databases is fault tolerant. So like one instance is down, another is still available. But ELB is highly available. So don't worry about this. This would be always available. Highly available web service where servers are not fault tolerant by default. Virtual servers are not we have to make the solutions like implemented properly so we can have create the fault tolerant for this. Amazon cannot have EC2 instance by default as a fault tolerant. Important points for AWS: you can use API to automate many services like network creations, deploy virtual servers, create databases, etc. So if this automation can be done, we will discuss about in few minutes. Write code for infrastructure and create blueprints to automate this infrastructure. We'll be creating the blueprints and using this blueprint, the entire infrastructure will be created. You can create infrastructure with a single node or 2000 nodes of the clusters. Many data parts of data you can store it. Many services are fault tolerant or highly available. No need to pay extra for using those services. This is freely available for you. Like you are not paying for ELB's high availability. High availability by default is Amazon responsibility to provide it. Fault tolerant databases. You are not paying extra for the fault tolerant databases. It is by default is available. It's Amazon responsibility to give you the fault tolerant database. Interacting with the AWS API. Okay, so now interacting with AWS API means all the services actually you are accessing from the Amazon is via API only. Okay, even we say we are using the web interface, but let's assume it this is the entire AWS cloud, AWS infrastructure represent, and this is from sitting at your office. You are using the AWS console, you are managing this service. But what happens here is the API layer in between. So whenever from the AWS console you make a request, it goes to the API and API manages the services inside the AWS, whatever you are going to be. So there would be always this layer in between. Okay, so web interface to interact with AWS services is the management console. Most of the time we will be using this consoles only. So this is the diagram I just show you. Even if you are using the any interface, API layer would always come. So just web console, you are using it to manage the web service, but it goes through APIs, AWS services. There's another ways like command line tool, like just PuTTY and something we will be using kind of thing. So similarly, command line interface is available for AWS. So we'll be using API layer for this. SDKs, so various, like most of the developers use Java or Python or JavaScript to do their development, or .NET, etc. So what you have to use the SDKs developed in the Java and Python or corresponding languages for AWS services, and you can use this SDK. This SDK is responsible for calling the API to manage the service. And blueprint is the you have coded your infrastructure and you deploy the blueprints and it creates the entire infrastructure. I'll tell you in few minutes. So as you move from this direction to this directions, like manual to automations, you're moving kind of thing. If you're using web console, it's more manual. Command line is also manual. SDK is less manual and blueprint is completely automated solution. So CLI can be used to automate a task on the AWS. CLI is the convenient way to interact with the AWS API. SDKs, you can use following SDKs for the, like even Android applications, you can be using, can use the AWS services, JavaScript using Node.js, PHP, so various SDKs are available. Like you are doing development using Java and want to use AWS services, then use Java SDK to interact with the AWS. So this is the Java applications. Your Java application would be holding the AWS SDK in the Java. And so whatever your application calls using the AWS SDK, it call goes to the API, and from API to the AWS services, or MySQL, like you are fetching the data from the MySQL database. So some services like queues and topics must be used with an SDK in your applications. What is the blueprint? You create a blueprint. It is a file in which you mentions all the services you need to create for your infrastructure. Okay, so you just mention in the file, and it would be you deploy this file, and the entire infrastructure will be created for you. You just submit a blueprint file, and it will create a running system for you. Generally, you will be creating complex services in the AWS, then you will be having the blueprint. So if you have complex solutions in place or need to implement an infrastructure, then you should use the blueprint. That is the very convenient way to create those complex infrastructure. So let's assume it, this is your blueprint file, correct? So we are saying created infrastructure which has one load balancer inside this, servers, three servers inside this, one CDN, it has to be there, one database needs to be there, one DNS needs to be there, and one some static contents are there. So as soon as you submit this file to the AWS, AWS will create all the services for you. And in which order, that is not we have mentioned anywhere, but it will create all the services for you. So it will create one load balancer. So this is one load balancer. It will create three servers. Like this is the sample script. Okay, this is not actual script. Okay, and three servers we are saying. So three servers will be created for your EC2 instances. CDN will be created here. This is the one CDN will be created. We are saying one database needs to be created. RDBMS, and we are saying we want DNS is required, so DNS service would be created. Some static content would be created in this S3 store. So these kind of things would be pre-created. So what happens, like generally, is you create a development database or a development cluster, a test cluster, and production cluster. Three the clusters you need to create it on your AWS. So what you have to do, you create a blueprint and use this blueprint to create the different infrastructure. All infrastructures are same, but you can use this blueprint files to create the infrastructure in AWS. So you just submit this file, and the entire infrastructure is ready for you in few minutes or in few hours. So that is what the blueprint about the AWS. So that's all in this session. In the next session, we'll be creating the account of in the AWS and choose some handsets by connecting the AWS and doing more things. So thanks for watching this session. And if you're watching on the YouTube, don't forget to subscribe it. And these are the all services by provided by the Hadoop Exam Learning Resources. So please keep visiting hadoopexam.com, and I hope you like the sessions. We will be keep creating this kind of sessions.